Welcome to the 8th grade moving up ceremony. Please remain standing for America the Beautiful.
To welcome the members of the Board of Education, President Sickles, Vice President Tucci, Mr. Heller, Mr. Hodes, Mrs. O'Keefe, Mr. Pippola, and the administration, Dr. Mustick, Dr. Bucci, Dr. Ferraro, Dr. Lutinski, Ms. Longabucco, Mrs. Babcock, Ms. Santangelo, Mrs. Wallace, and Mr. Seglia. Like everything in life, middle school had its hard parts, as well as the great times I love to think about. Through the 4 years I spent here, I've changed so much, not only cosmetically, but also emotionally. When I graduated from fourth grade, I remember I promised myself I would be special. I planned to go to middle school and to be beautiful, fun, and accomplish things no one had done before. Needless to say, that didn't happen. Primarily because the end of fourth grade was the worst of my awkward phase. I was chubby, had just gotten glasses, and didn't know that my hair was curly. This caused severe trauma every morning as I fought with my hairbrush, trying to create silky, smooth hair, only making the frizz worse. My feet were too big for my body, and to make matters worse, I had found out I would be getting braces. I was scared, and it took everything I had to get from my locker to math class. And once I was there, it was even worse. Fifth grade was tough, I won't lie. I realized that I didn't have a niche. I wasn't pretty, I wasn't athletic, and I wasn't an actress. I thought I was hopeless. I cried every day, if not more, and this freaked out the majority of my teachers. Not that I can blame them. I believed that if I looked better, my whole life would change. I thought that what I needed was for other people to like me and to want to be my friend. The friends I did have, though, showed me that I was more than I was giving myself credit for. I didn't need to be gorgeous or athletic to be a good person. Gradually, my opinions changed, and I realized that I had to be content with who I was, because I wasn't going anywhere. I had always looked to my parents so they could fix all my problems, but they couldn't save me every time I needed them anymore. I was going to be on my own from now on, and I had to learn to get on by myself. Throughout the years here, though, I realized I was never really alone, because people who I loved and who loved me would always be there to support me. I found that alone was something I didn't like to be, and I don't think I ever will be. Eventually, school became something I looked forward to, like the way it was when I was in elementary school. I still hadn't given up on my dream of being special, though, and I continued to try to find my star, which in first grade was something I had learned everyone had. The problem was, whatever I tried, I just wasn't the best at, and I would automatically write it off. For example, horseback riding was a total bust because I was allergic to horses. And dance camp, which turned out to be for people who knew how to dance. I don't know what it was that I accepted the fact that maybe I didn't have a special gift. Maybe I was just great at being me. I learned that I shouldn't spend all my time looking for things I could do. What I should have been doing was embracing who I already was. I met people who appreciated my odd sense of humor and talent for always having something to say, and I loved being around them. The more fun I had, the more confident I became. Now that middle school is over, it's interesting to see where I ended up. I'm not an athlete, or a model, or a brilliant singer. I'm just me, and I'm happy to say that I'm perfectly fine with that. The most important thing I learned in middle school is that loving yourself doesn't come from whatever special talent you may have. It just comes from being someone you can be proud of.
It is my pleasure to introduce Dr. Mustick, Superintendent of Schools.
Well, I think we can all agree, she's articulate, she's poised, she is very special. What a wonderful. Beautifully done. Congratulations and welcome to the 2010 Reinet Middle School graduation. This event marks one of the most significant transitions our students make. You've already made it through one of the most challenging times of your life, and I promise that everything after middle school is a breeze. Today is a celebration of success and a time to reflect on past accomplishments. It's also a time to look forward to the exciting years of high school. Today we come together to honor our graduates, their parents, their teachers, their principal, for their collective hard work and dedication to success. Graduates, remember, you are who you are, and what you do speaks louder to the world than anything you might say. Everybody who knows me knows I like to tell stories at the graduations, and today's no different. I have a story about the Brooklyn Bridge. I was reading about the bridge and how it started, and it's really quite amazing. In 1855, a very creative engineer by the name of John Roebling was inspired to build the bridge connecting New York and Long Island. Well, you can imagine, however, that the bridge building experts throughout the world thought this was an impossible feat and told Roebling to forget the idea. Roebling couldn't ignore the vision. He thought about it all the time and knew deep in his heart that it really could be done. He just had to share this dream with someone else. So after much discussion and persuasion, he managed to convince his son, Washington, an up-and-coming engineer, that the bridge in fact could be built. Working together for the first time, this father and son team developed the concepts of how the bridge could be built and how the obstacles could be overcome. With great excitement and inspiration and a wild challenge ahead of them, they hired their crew and began to build their dream bridge in 1869. That's 14 years later. So for 14 years, they worked on the planning. The project started out well enough, but when it was only a few months underway, a tragic accident happened, and it took the life of John Roebling. Washington, his son, was badly injured as well. He was left with a certain amount of brain damage, which resulted in him not being able to talk, walk, and with limited mobility. Everybody had negative comments to make and felt that the project should be scrapped, since the Roeblings were the only ones who really knew how the bridge could be built. We told you so, crazy men and their crazy dreams. It's foolish to chase wild visions. However, in spite of his handicap, Washington was more determined than ever to complete the project. So, from his hospital room by the river, he could observe the construction site using a telescope. His wife, Emily, became his eyes and ears on the construction site and served as the messenger between him and his staff. Roebling even taught his wife the fundamentals of engineering so that she could give more accurate instructions and reports. Amazingly, the bridge was completed on May 24th, 1883, 28 years after the original vision. Today, this spectacular Brooklyn Bridge stands as a triumph and a tribute to one man's determination and his refusal to be defeated by circumstances. It's also a tribute to this man's wife, to the engineers, and to their teamwork, and to their faith in a man who the world considered was mad. Perhaps this is one of the best examples of a never say die attitude that overcomes terrible physical handicap and achieves the impossible goal. The Brooklyn Bridge shows us that dreams, even the most distant dreams, can be realized with determination and persistence. My words to the graduates today, hold fast to your dreams. Congratulations.
Please welcome Dr. Rutinsky, principal of the middle school.
Good morning. Good morning. Sam, I have to say that that absolutely touched me, and I think you may underestimate yourself. That was a fantastic speech, and I think it was excellent honesty and role modelship. Thank you very much. My speech I wrote, I think, much later than I normally do. So this may have affected my initial choices of topic. I considered procrastination, less is more, and improv. But in the end, it was a conversation that I had with Dr. Mustick last week over the heavy responsibility we feel that's attached to giving speeches that I decided to focus on responsibility. There are many responsibilities that we have throughout our lives. They change and develop, but generally stay with us. For example, from preschool, we're taught that it's our responsibility to share. Everyone deserves a turn on the slide, and since you've been using that sandbox shovel long enough, it's now the other kid's turn. If you bring in Valentine's Day cards or birthday cupcakes, it's your responsibility to bring in one for everyone. If you play t-ball, everyone gets an at-bat each inning, no one loses, and your season record again is 0-0-10. Mom and Dad carried out their responsibilities by taking care of yours. They had a hand in bringing in the cupcakes and coaching t-ball. However, the idea is that their examples rub off and you learn the responsibilities associated with living in our society. By eighth grade, you're expected to know a lot more about how to do for yourself without preventing others from doing the same. You should be aware of the basic relationships in which you bear responsibility: self, family, friends, and society. We're expected to have a general sense of each, and as we age, we're expected to adjust what we do to keep pace with our obligations. At this point in life, you should be conscious of many personal responsibilities. You bathe yourself, brush your teeth, and get dressed by yourself. In school, you're expected to lock your locker, write down what your homework is, walk in the hallways, and respect classmates. These last ones are not always easy, so it's common to find that adults still help you. Your parents have either checked your agenda to make sure that no assignments have been forgotten, or they've gone on the teacher web pages after you've lost the agenda. Your teachers might have asked you for homework in case you forgot that it's in your binder, and they may have stopped you from running so that you don't knock over any little sixth graders. But what you're about to do is a whole new level of responsibility. High school is more than just the next four grade levels. It's the transition to independence
and the responsibilities that come along with it. I think the biggest difference, however, is not just the list of things that you're responsible for, it's the self-discipline and motivation necessary to carry them out. You will need to approach your teachers to inquire about grades and extra help without your parents doing it first. You will need to communicate to your guidance counselor what your college ambitions are so that you can plan for your undergraduate degree. You will need to learn how and when to say no to your friends so that your actions represent what's in your best interest, not theirs, and yet look out for them at the same time. The biggest difference here is to live up to these responsibilities. And for that, you need to have the discipline to do what you should do in spite of reasons not to. I'd like to therefore get to the point and summarize what I think are your new responsibilities. Booker T. Washington said, "Few things help an individual more than to place responsibility upon them." Since you're mine for only a few more minutes, I will conclude my responsibility to you by telling you what to do one last time. First, there's the personal. It's your responsibility, and it may be ultimately your responsibility alone, to keep your body healthy and your mind free from distractions. This isn't rocket science. Go to sleep at a reasonable hour, be conscious of your own grades, and take care of your property. It does take discipline and practice, but don't take the easy way out or put things off until it's too late. Abraham Lincoln said, "You cannot escape the responsibility of tomorrow by evading it today," and he was pretty smart. Next, there's family responsibility. They got you this far, so return the favor and keep them in mind when you act. Remember from sixth grade social studies the emphasis Confucius put on family? Well, there's a reason he's famous. At the end of the day, you must make sure you're setting a good example for your siblings, taking advantage of the gifts given to you by your parents, and making sure that your actions result in respect for anyone that shares your family name. Just go buy the Brady Bunch DVD series and do what they do. Then there's friend responsibility, probably one of the toughest. There's that old saying, you can choose your friends, but you can't choose your relatives. Choose your friends wisely, and make sure that your friendships are based on common interests and trust. Suffragettes Susan B. Anthony and Elizabeth Cady Stanton, founding fathers Thomas Jefferson and John Adams, Megan Fox and Shia LaBeouf and Transformers, all had friendships with tough times, but were supportive and constructive to both in the end. And finally, there's social responsibility. There are many famous examples of people who viewed their existence as pieces of a whole. Jane Addams became the first American woman to win a Nobel Peace Prize for her work helping immigrants in Chicago. Right now, people are traveling to the Gulf of Mexico to help clean up the oil spill in the same way that they helped others after Katrina, Haiti, or right after our own Mamaroneck flood. But it doesn't have to be global. It can be right here, every day. Don't cut on lines. Don't leave your laundry or garbage around for others to clean up. And don't act like people on reality TV shows. Instead, hold the door for others. Go help your neighbor, volunteer, and be polite. You can do this. As a matter of fact, you must do this. You've done amazing things so far. As a class, you have the personality to affect the planet. And as individuals, you each have the ability to immediately affect those in your own universe. Our future depends on it, and it's now your responsibility to make sure that I didn't write this speech for nothing. Thank you.
Is that we don't always get our way. No one can just wish for something to happen. You must get out there and do it yourself, whatever it may be, whether it's a position in a sport or a certain grade in a class. Certain things just won't ever be handed to you. You must work for them and prove you deserve it. Ever since middle school began, I've tried my hardest at everything I have done, whether academically or athletically. I do this because when you work hard, somehow it will always pay off. In fifth grade, we came to middle school excited and nervous at the same time. We were all excited about the freedom, happy we wouldn't have to go outside on the playground or eat lunch at a certain time in the period. Yet most of us didn't realize the responsibility that came with the freedom. This responsibility made me the person I am, a person who is strong, competitive, and is sure of what she wants. I have learned through experience that school is my main priority. To participate in any clubs or sports and keep up your grades, you must be able to manage your time. It is a priority as a student to be able to manage your time wisely. It's a bit stressful and sometimes overwhelming, but as years have gone by, I've been able to handle the stress and use time management to benefit myself, like finishing a project or homework in advance so that I can enjoy other activities or participate in more clubs and sports. When I began middle school, I didn't realize how one day of school is so important. I soon realized that it is nothing like elementary school. In elementary school, you can miss a day, and as soon as you get back, the teacher will go up to you and give you what you missed and explain it. In middle school, you have to take the initiative to get the stuff you missed, and if you don't understand it, you have to walk through the door and ask for help. The teachers are always willing to help, but as a student, I had to make the first step. I had to care enough about my responsibilities. As I became more responsible with my studies, I tried my hardest not to miss any school because I know how important each and every day is. I have also realized how important and rare good friends are. Some friends become best friends, while others become acquaintances. I have made new friends and kept old ones. And they help you up when you are down and can get you through any situation, whether large or small. I treasure the tears, the laughter, but most importantly, I treasure the memories. The middle school and the people in it allowed me to grow as a student and a person. I will cherish every experience, no matter how big or small, and take the extraordinary lessons I have learned onto high school. I enjoyed my middle school experiences, and I know we are all well prepared in what the future holds.
The class of 2010 chorus will now perform Little Wonders.
School and our friends move away, the memories we have with each other are the things that will stay. These little wonders are special and they make up our lives as we continue our journey, our mission to strong.
Time.
Middle school is an important yet often overlooked time. Although most don't see middle school as an important moment preparing you for the future, I do. Middle school is where you gain that first bit of independence, just enough to feel grown up, but not too much to handle. You are given your first test of responsibility. There are projects, exams, and homework, all happening at once, due at the same time, often for 8 different classes. You have to learn to budget your time because you don't always have as much help as you did in grade school. When we made the move into the big building, away from little old Bellows, it was easy to be awestruck and a bit overwhelmed. So many students, so many classes, everyone hustling and bustling through the halls. Where do I go? What do I do? Will I get lost? We didn't have to worry much about these things because the school was looking out for us. Most of our classes were in a neat little horseshoe-shaped wing. We learned to be responsible, to keep up with the homework for all our classes, and hand things in on time. Most importantly, we learn the value of reading. As Groucho Marx reminds us, outside of a dog, a book is a man's best friend. Inside of a dog, it's too dark to read. In sixth grade, we mixed with the rest of the school as some of our classes were out in the halls. Here, the learning process continued to grow and blossom. More work, more responsibility. We learned that being a proactive worker was good, and we were rewarded for doing our work thoroughly and well. Handing work in early could yield extra points, just as not handing work in on time would yield reductions. We learned lessons that prepared us for later in life. You couldn't show up late for class or come unprepared without paying the consequences. In seventh grade, we experienced even bigger changes and challenges. We really had to kick it into high gear because everything was taken up a notch. We had our first opportunity to compete in school sports for the modified teams, and we learned we had to bring our A game or be cut from the team. We had to accept this new level of competition. No participation ribbons would be awarded, no trophies would be handed out. We had to work hard to overcome these new challenges, and those who were the most dedicated did the best. I think the words of Weldon Drew summed up our first basketball season well when he said, "We had a great bunch of outside shooters. Unfortunately, all our games are played indoors." Now we have arrived at the end of our last year of middle school. In eighth grade, we probably learned the most. Here we had the most freedom and the most responsibility. The teachers would even collaborate with us on our work and special projects. In eighth grade, we prepared for the future more than ever. Some students were already taking high school courses and preparing for Regents exams, and some were already competing on our high school sports teams. We had to work harder, do better, and get it done faster. We were rewarded with the opportunity to travel to Washington, D.C., where our nation's history came to life, and we spent a night away from home with some of the best friends we will ever have. The most important thing that I learned in middle school was to work hard and be responsible. It has been said that success is a ladder you cannot climb with your hands in your pockets. You don't want to be the kid who looks for a piece of paper 2 minutes before class, yelling, "What are the answers to the homework?" That can only lead to disaster. Don't expect to get work done by others. Do the work yourself. As the great golfer Ben Hogan once said, the answers are in the dirt. We too must get down and dirty, find our own answers, and do the hard work ourselves. Middle school is one of the most important times in our lives, especially here at Rhinek, where we have been compelled to do everything to the best of our abilities. I will always remember the lessons I have learned here, and will take them with me into high school as we begin to prepare for college, and then to prepare for the real world. We should always keep in mind the lessons of hard work and responsibility that we have learned during our 4 years at Rhinek Middle School. They will serve us well in all our future endeavors. Best of luck and congratulations to all of my classmates in the 2010 8th grade class at Rhinek Middle School. Thank you.
Each year, the eighth grade class has a personality all its own. This year's class is no exception. They are intelligent, respectful, sincere, and sometimes even witty. They have learned many lessons, academic and otherwise. But the true mark of a class's impact is the lesson they teach their teachers. And the class of 2010 has left its impression on all of us. Their enthusiasm for discussion and willingness to try anything new and unusual has allowed us to push them beyond their own expectations. And in return, we, their teachers, have found refreshing dialogue, thoughtful interactions, and desire to delve deeper into the curriculum. We would like to honor your successes now with the presentation of some special awards. I'd like to invite Mr. Seglia and the eighth grade teachers to the stage to help us recognize those students who have met success in their various endeavors throughout the school year. The first award is the Three Sport Award, given to athletes who participate in three seasons of sports in their eighth grade year. Ashley Abatantono. Ryan Aquino. Tiffany Asnar. Alyssa Barchetta. Michael Bianco. Samantha Bradley. Jacob Calvini. Chris Cascione. Matt Franks. Matt Garcia. Max Grasso. Lawrence Deenan. Yuria Koga. Sibylla Mangianati Dutoni. Sarah O'Brien. Molly O'Shea. Chris Pinnell. Thomas Piccolo. Angelo Spedafino. Tyler Spinelli. Grant Sundstrom. J. Jake Swinghammer. And Neo Takai. The next award is for excellence in English. Jordan Julian. For achievement in English as a second language, Mio Takai. For excellence in Regents Algebra, Rachel Hurst. For excellence in Regents Geometry, Jake Swinghammer. Excellence in Math 8, Samantha Davis. Excellence in Regents Biology, Mallory Shaner. Excellence in Science 8, Annabelle Gutterman. Excellence in Social Studies, Luke Murphy. Excellence in French, Native Speaker, Nicholas Cargill. Excellence in French, Non-Native Speaker, Mallory Shaner. Excellence in Italian, Native Speaker, Taylor Joan. Excellence in Italian, Non-Native Speaker, Anthony Zadinoff. Excellence in Spanish, Native Speaker, Carla Gonzalez. Excellence in Spanish, non-native speaker, Brianna Andrioli. Excellence in Art, Oakley Carney. Outstanding contribution in band, Luke Murphy. Effort and commitment in bands, Luis Ferreira. Outstanding musician in chorus and an all-county chorus member, Hannah Greenberg. Outstanding contribution in chorus, Mallory Shaner. Outstanding achievement in theater arts, Brianna Andrioli. Outstanding performance in theater arts, Grace Sundstrom. Overall, most consistent effort, Gabriela Rios. Most improved throughout middle school, Michael Bianco. I'd like to ask Dr. Lutinsky to present a couple of awards. The next award is for students achieving high honor roll status for all of 7th and 8th grade. Rihanna Andrioli. Samantha Davis. Lawrence Geenan. Rachel Hurst. Jordan Julian. Taylor Jung. Chisa Kakigawa. Faye McMahon. Luke Murphy. Sarah O'Brien. Molly O'Shea. Hannah Redding. Mallory Shaner. Gabriel Sipiora. Jake Swinghammer. Madeline Wong. And Anthony Zadanoff. The award for overall academic excellence goes to Faye McMahon. And the principal's award for character goes to Sam Palero. Mustick is going to help us hand out some special awards. The first is from the American Association of University Women for accomplishments in both math and science. Taylor Jung. Chisa Kakigawa. and Maddie Wong. The next award is a certificate of special congressional recognition for service to the community. It goes to Brianna Andrioli. And the final award is from the State of New York Comptroller's Award for Academic Excellence and Civic Commitment. It goes to Samantha Espada. Thank you, Dr. Mason. Now, Dr. Lutinski will present the certificates. I'd like to ask that you hold your applause until the end. And first, I'd like to invite Daniel Warren nurse Wendy Abatantono to the stage to present her certificate to her daughter. Ashley Abatantono. Lori Lynn Akampora. Daniela Aguilar. Nozomi Ambi. Brianna Andrioli. Ryan Aquino. Michelle Arak. Austin Aviles Desatnik. Tiffany Asnar. Jacob Barak. Alyssa Barchetta. Brianna Barreto. Brandon Bell. Charles Birmingham. Michael Bianco. Samantha Bradley. Jacob Calvini. Nicholas Cargill. Christopher Cascione. Peter Castor. Nicholas Colantonio. Hernan Cortez. Pedro Cueto. Jeffrey Doherty. Samantha Davis. Maxwell Denenberg. I'd like to invite Effie Bellows nurse Kim Barth to the stage to give her son his certificate. Andrew Duszynski. William Defoe. Lauren Ennis. Samantha Espada. Louis Ferrara. Marisol Finkenberg. Matthew Franks. Matthew Garcia. Tiara Garcia. Lawrence Geenan. Matthew Beeson. Sarah Gladstein. Carla Gonzalez. Javier Gonzalez. Maximilian Grasso. Hannah Greenberg. Joshua Greenberg. Annabelle Gutterman. Andy Guzia. Shelby Hackenberg. Leah Haviland. Rachel Hurst. Madison Jensen. Leanne Ures. Catherine Jubin. Jordan Julian. Taylor Jung. Chisa Kakigawa. Oakley Carney. Lauren Kim. Daniel King. Rio Kitamura. Yuria Koga. Nikki Lee Kosminski. Jason Leeds. Amanda Lara. Sibylla Longinati Butoni. Amanda Lavallo. Charles Luzio. Jack Lynch. Gordon McKenzie. Elizabeth Maffei. Craig Maggio.
Attaboy!
Steven Martino. Camilla Martins. Faye McMahon. Sarah Melgarejo. Jack Myers. Melanie Moore. Ryan Morningstar. Luke Murphy. Sarah O'Brien. Molly O'Shea. Christopher Pinnell. Fatima Perez. Luke Petrillo. Jake Peterman. Sam Palero. Jessica Pineda. I'd like to invite board member Guy Piccolo to the stage to give his son his certificate. Thomas Piccolo. Jake Pacella. Nancy Rangel. Scott Recca. Hannah Redding. Gabriela Rios. Mark Rosenzweig. Elena Ruiz Gomez. Caitlin Scott. Joshua Segovia. Luis Servin. Mallory Shaner. Cameron Shaw. Samantha Sheldon. Gabriel Scipiora. I'd like to invite fourth grade teacher Joan Spadafino and former board member Frank Spadafino to the stage to give their son his certificate. Angelo Spadafino. Tyler Spinelli. Cindy Stetson. Everest Strayer. Grace Sundstrom. Brant Sundstrom. Jake Swinghammer. Mio Takai. Jealous Tamale. Carl Tempesta. Nino Trapicchio. Hannah Ufelder. Samantha Beltry. Nicole Violi. Zachary Bullenweiler. Rachel Williams. Madeline Wong. Anthony Zadanoff.
High School graduating class of 2014.
Please stand while the class of 2010 exits the auditorium.
Thank you.